I'm going to get up because I would like to sit down and talk. I'd like to thank Beth and the Historical Society for having this panel. And Beth, you'll be pleased to know that the Historical Society's author book was Robert's Box, so he said he's a founder of the Historical Society. He was an abolitionist, so he's not implicated in any of the controversies, nor is the Historical Society going to be subject to the But it's alone, really, in many ways, in Philadelphia. If you look at the landscape of the country over the last couple of months, it seems to be exploding with controversies over Confederate monuments and so forth. But they seem to come out of nowhere, but they don't. The virtue of, and the vice of public monuments is that they're there until, and generally unnoticed, until they're not. And then they generally become subject to controversy. And this is true in Philadelphia and across the country. And largely the controversies here and around the country fall along racial lines. Race is inflammatory, and it's always been inflammatory in this country, for good reason, obviously. Today, I don't think there are any Confederate monuments in Philadelphia, actually. I don't think there's any public statuary related to the Confederacy. I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's true. But we do have Frank Rizzo, who makes up for a lot of that. I'm sure we'll hear more about that later. But just to give a little bit of perspective about the city and its interactions with monuments that raise questions about race, I thought I'd go back a little bit in history. Because they're monuments commemorating Black people or Black experience have been virtually invisible in the city. In fact, I think the first commemorative sculptures displayed publicly were in the Centennial Exhibition in 1876, when a statue called Freed Slave was exhibited in Memorial Hall, which is the art center for the exhibition. And it was a piece that was done by Austrian and Italian sculptor whose name was Francisco Pizarro. But in any event, it was highly popular. But it was submitted by a foreign government and was therefore admitted to the Centennial. The only sculpture by an American group that was submitted was a bust of Richard Allen. It was supposed to be a giant memorial, but it was late being made in Ohio, and then the train bearing the memorial to the Centennial, which was almost over, crashed into a canyon in western Pennsylvania. Finally, the last week at Centennial, they got the bus to Richard Allen to the fairgrounds, and it was displayed for a week. That was it for a very long time, until 1930, when a very well-known sculptor at that time, Antonio Salome, became very good friends with Paul Robeson, and sculpted a terrific nude statue of Robeson with his arms looped like this for the Art Alliance for display in their then very prestigious Rittenhouse Square art show. But the trustees of the Art Alliance, when they saw this, said, there's no way this sculpture is going to go up in public in Philadelphia, particularly because the colored problem is so difficult in the city. So it was never displayed in Philadelphia. About 4 years later, Pennsylvania legislator, maybe he was from Philadelphia, Samuel Park, spearheaded an effort to commemorate the contributions of African American soldiers to the nation's wars. And eventually this became what we know now as the All Wars Memorial for Colored Soldiers and Sailors. It was approved for a location on the Parkway, but then became mired in controversy. The art jury wanted it there. The art jury opposed its positioning on the Parkway. They said there were too many war memorials and they were all mediocre. And they suggested they put it in Fiddler Square. The African American communities said that Fiddler Square was a debauched location, not fitting for civilized commemoration for the contributions of the African American citizens of this country. They wouldn't have it. So there was this back and forth that became quite racial, actually. Ultimately, it was put behind Memorial Hall. But then, 60 years later, I suspect this is indicative of some kind of progress. It was moved to the location it is today, which is off to Logan Circle, Logan Square, near the Franklin Institute. So if we fast forward today, we can see that there are roots of contention over racial matters, which relate to, who makes the decisions about these monuments? Where do they go? What do we want to commemorate as a community? And in the past, this was all largely decided by white men, because white men control money and power talks when you come to public memorials. And when you look at the city today, it's largely not a white city in the way it was 60, 70 years ago. This is a city that changes like all cities. But monuments are always put there forever. So our relationships with each other change, but the monuments stay the same. Now, most monuments live a life that where they're only noticed when they're bumped into. In the wake of the Dylan Roof killings in South Carolina, that really sort of focused attention on what kind of society we have that commemorates slave masters and people who devoted their lives to not only keeping people in bondage, but the global war organization. And Charlottesville refocused that attention and raised a whole host of questions about what history is, how we perceive our past, the different angles that perceptions of the past come from, and who ultimately makes the decisions. Now, today, for instance, in Austin, Texas, the city council voted to eliminate Columbus Day and made it Indigenous Peoples Day, which is something that is a number of cities and even states have been doing. There are two Columbus monuments in Philadelphia. There's been some discussion about whether they're appropriate, whether the values that they represent are the kinds of values that we want to celebrate in an equitable society. So I think that our two panels here can probably address the particulars of these issues, but I think it's important to think of monuments as not simply street furniture, but important emblems of identity that change depending on who's looking at them. And who's looking at them might not be the same kinds of people that put them in place in the first instance. So with that, I'll turn it over to you.
There you go. Sure. To acknowledge and reckon with histories of indigenous histories. So for instance, when we're thinking about public space in Philadelphia, it's important to acknowledge we're not just in the city of Philadelphia, we're in Lenape country as well. And I think that that needs to be conscious to everyone who talks about public space in, you know, in our contemporary society. Even after colonization, I think it's really important to pay attention that there's no natural or definition, evident definition of public space. Public spaces are constructed, they're continuing to be constructed today. So it's really important to pay attention to the histories of how these spaces came to be, whether that be a park or a municipal plaza. It's important to think about that when we think about what monuments should be there, how they should be represented, and what histories have already shaped these spaces that have come to be. These histories of change should absolutely sort of help us think again about monuments and what their meanings are. So a quick example, I'll sort of center on the Municipal Services Building. Why would I be talking about the Municipal Services Building today? Anyone know?
Rizzo.
Rizzo, okay, right? This is where the Frank Rizzo statue is, which has come under heavy debate. I'm sure many of you know sort of the fate of this statue here in the city. And it's absolutely important to think about, you know, who was Frank Rizzo? How did that statue come to be? How do particular communities have different competing memories in the city? All of that is absolutely important, but what I want us to also add to that conversation is thinking about what is the history of the Municipal Services Building, how did the space around it come to be, and how might that help us think about should the statue be here, is there another place for it, how does it work, and what is the meaning of this memorial in this specific space. So, Municipal Services Building, built in 1962, built by Vincent Kling, modernist architect, worked with Ed Bacon, trained at Cornell, sort of came out of the same ethos of wanting to sort of redevelop and renew Philadelphia. I'm sure many of you remember this moment, right? I'm not telling you anything new here. But what I'd like to propose is that the Rizzo debate should think about two distinct points about this physical space in our city. One is that it was created in sort of this modernist ideal of what public space should be, and specifically what public urban space should be. So, you know, this is a historically rooted ideal, a sort of a physical expression of how cities can bring people together. Kling had this quote, it's a bit after he built the Municipal Services Building. It's a little bit later in the 60s, but on one hand, we can say this is a throwaway point. On the other hand, I do think it gets to really what the ideal of public urban space was for these modernist architects. He wrote, "Our fundamental conviction in approaching the design of every project is that architecture is for the people. The greatest challenge to the architect is to recreate environments for the people. Elegance, grace, style, functional efficiency, economy, and durability are all still important to owners as ever. But today the most pressing need is for humane spaces in which people can live and breathe." So, you know, public plazas, these spaces around, really, again, were the formal ideal of what Kling and modernists wanted to create. Of course, we know this idea of democracy and people bringing people together is sort of honed in this Cold War era, in this moment where there's this belief that democracy will move along the lines that these architects want, right? They have this vision that if we just gather people together in the American way, it's going to go in a particular way and our ideas will be confirmed. Of course, we know that that is not necessarily what happened and that many people contest what really should happen and what sort of movements should form among people in these public spaces. So, you know, certainly this ideal of modernist urban public space is problematic. It's not necessarily what's happened, but I think it should be one that informs how we use the space of Rayburn Plaza, Thomas Paine Plaza, out in front of the Municipal Services Building. Second point that I think we should consider is the history of how this building was actually built. right? So it has a pretty troubled history of how this building was built. It was an $18 million project during a building boom in Philadelphia in the 60s to redevelop the space. And the contractors and labor unions who built it started their work, and there was a huge pushback because of racial discrimination in the building trade, not an issue that has disappeared, obviously. So protesters get Mayor Tate to stop construction in 1963, the NAACP, as well as Coard, the Congress of Racial Equality, right? Sorry, had a synod in the mayor's office, right? And he said, this is a public building. We shouldn't be contracting out to groups who are not practicing fair labor practices. So there's a stop construction order. There's sort of eventually agreements reached. But this building was built and put up in a moment where there was a demand for equality of access to profit, to two building contracts that are sort of rebuilding the city in the modernist ideal. And I think it's important to know that the labor unions push back and say it's not a matter of racial discrimination, it's a matter of loyalty to family and loyalty to ethnicity. Again, a similar argument that we continue to hear today in some of these debates over monuments. So I won't take any more time, but I'll just wrap up by saying, again, that I think it's really important that we think about histories of particular places, and to understand that debates over, for instance, the Rizzo Monument, these monuments are real arguments, not just in who and how people should be remembered, but arguments in conversations that we may not necessarily be aware of, arguments that are ground in location and histories of place, not just memories of particular people. Thank you.
I had actually planned to sit down, but since the doctor stood up, I'm forced to stand up. Let me start by quoting Dr. Du Bois, who said the problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line. He meant in America the 19th century, the 18th century, and the 21st century. So when we start talking about all this stuff, and I'm so glad the good doctor used the word debate, because the issue of who gets a memorial, who gets a statue, who gets a monument has become a debate, but it really shouldn't be a debate. For example, it should be a given that if you slaughter a whole race of people, you don't get a monument. It's as simple as that. I mean, there shouldn't be a debate. I mean, the fact that we actually discuss Christopher Columbus is absolutely mind-boggling to me. And when I say, by the way, I was introduced and I am a lawyer, but I describe myself as the angriest black man in America. And I actually choked that from Richard Baldwin, who said, when it comes down to black folks, in fact, when it comes down to any black person, black man, black woman, black child, it all comes down to this: to be black and conscious in America is to be in a constant state of rage. Let me repeat that. To be black and conscious in America is to be in a constant state of rage. And why do I say that? Do I mean rage like running out, yelling, and screaming, and fighting, and all that? No, I don't. I mean understanding slavery, understanding sharecropping, understanding convict leasing, understanding Jim Crow, understanding school segregation, understanding mass incarceration, understanding police killing unarmed black people on video and getting acquitted. Knowing all of this stuff, how could you not be angry? I mean, think about that. If white folks in America went through the hell that black folks went through in America, we wouldn't be discussing this kind of stuff. It would just be a given that this kind of thing is outrageous. Now, I actually, when I got up to speak, I had all my thoughts lined up in chronological order, but now I got all excited and angry, so I'm not sure where I'm going to go. But I really had it all organized. That's what I think about Columbus and got distracted. But I want to come back to Columbus. The reason I'm here is I'm not just a lawyer, but I started my whole historical monument kind of thing, activism, in 2000, specifically in year 2002. You might say, but what happened in year 2002? Well, the National Park Service, over basically a jurisdiction over Independence Mall in 2002, said that they were going to move the Liberty Bell from its then site, 5th and Market, a half block west to 6th and Market. Okay, so we in the black community said, okay, interesting, but not really relevant to us. But then the second thing that Park Service said in the year 2002, not only are we moving the Liberty Bell, and they moved it for reasons of space, it was just too congested and there was more space at 6th and Market. So one, they're moving the Liberty Bell from 5th and Market to 6th and Market. We in the black community said, interesting, but not really relevant. And then we found out that same year 2002 that the site of the new Liberty Bell Center, 6th and Market, is where America's first White House stood. Back in 1790, it was known as the Robert Morris Mansion, or the Executive Mansion, and we call it the President's House. But basically, what it came down to was America's first White House. So you got the move from 5th and Market to 6th and Market. You got the move to America's first White House. But then the third thing we found out is that George Washington, the father of this country, enslaved 316 black men, black women, and black children at his Mount Vernon, Virginia plantation, and illegally held 9 here in Philadelphia. You might say, well, how could it be illegal? It was 1790, didn't slavery exist? Well, in Pennsylvania, not really, because based on the Graduate Abolition Act of 1780, if you brought in enslaved black folks into Pennsylvania and held them for 6 consecutive months, at the end of that 6-month period, they could petition for their freedom. So what would George Washington do? He would take them across state lines at 5 months, 29 days. And that way they have to start the 6-month time all over again. But what he didn't know, what his lawyer didn't tell him, is that although that 6-month thing applied in 1780, in 1788 the law said that, hey, we're finding out that people are trying to circumvent the law. So if we find out you're doing that, and we're going to free the people that you have enslaved, and we're going to fine you. But George Washington continued to do that. So my point is, the position of my organization, ATAC, A-T-A-C, Avenging the Ancestors Coalition. And by the way, in terms of that name, Avenging the Ancestors Coalition, we have a website. And a lot of people, and I have to admit, a lot of white folks, were complaining not about what we stood for, but what our name represented. Avenging. That just sounded too confrontational. It sounded too threatening. It sounded too black. But what they didn't understand is that avenge and revenge are not synonymous.
That's right.
Revenge and avenge are two completely different things. Revenge means I'll do to you what you did to me. Revenge focuses on the victimizer. I'm going to get him for doing what he did. That's revenge. Avenge is completely different. It focuses on the victim, to help the victim up. So when we call ourselves Avenging the Ancestors Coalition, we're avenging our enslaved ancestors. But getting back to the point, our argument to the Park Service beginning in 2002 was this. If you want to say that George Washington was a great patriot, you can say that. If you want to say he was a great general, you can say that. If you want to say he was a great president, you can say that. But can you be a great human being when you hold 316 other human beings in brutal bondage as slaves? That's a rhetorical question. But our fight was not to stop the George Washington monument, because one thing I didn't mention is that once the Park Service realized that the 6th and Market site was America's first White House, they decided to build something to memorialize George Washington at that site. And that's when this group ATAC was founded. We were like, no, you can tell the story of George Washington, the patriot, the general, the president, but that's only part of the story. If this is about truth, it's got to be about the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So now when you go to Sixth and Market, you see whatever you want to see there about George Washington, but now you see and hear, and even better, you feel the story of what he did to enslaved human beings. Forget the fact that they're black. I'm talking about enslaved human beings. So for groups like ATTAC and for black people generally, this stuff is not about debates. It's about looking at the historical record and making things right. If I say to you all, how many of you love that great memorial they have down at 4th and Catherine, honoring all those black people? You say, what memorial at 8th and Catherine, South Philly, memorializing all the black people? Well, you can say that because it's not there, but it should be. I'm sure, and all of you are bright people, many of you are historians, but how many of you know that at 4th and Catherine is the Bethel Burying Ground? And at the Bethel Burying Ground, there are as many as 8,000, if not more, black people from the early 1800s buried under a trash dump and a city playground. Think about that. How could that be in the North? How could that be in Pennsylvania? How could that be in Philadelphia that 8,000 black folks from one of the most pivotal periods in American history are buried under a damn trash dump and a city playground, and nobody knows anything about it? But you'll build a Rizzo statue. And even talking about Rizzo, it's not even up for debate when we talk about Rizzo, because I'm a lawyer, I'm a criminal defense attorney. You might say, well, I'm a lawyer, so I'm going to be I'm a criminal defense lawyer, so I might be anti-cop, and I'm a black guy, so I'm going to be against Rizzo. But the facts speak for itself. Here you've got Frank Rizzo, and by the way, I warned you, I'm going to be jumping all around. I'm going to be from George Washington to 4th and Catherine to Frank Rizzo, but I'm going to bring it all around. But getting back to Frank Rizzo in terms of this whole thing about the debate question, here you have a situation where, as police commissioner, he ordered black men, who happen to be members of the Black Panther Party, strip search in public. Okay, that's one thing. And then you got him getting busted in a lie detector test. That's another thing. And then you got 250,000 voters in Philadelphia signing a recall petition. That's another thing. And pardon my language, but he said he was going to make Attila the Hun look like a faggot. Think about that. Everything I just told you is a documented fact, but it doesn't stop there. He fomented racial strife at Whitman Park when black folks are trying to get public housing. White reporters at the school district doing a protest by black students for black history courses quoted Frank Rizzo as saying, kick their black asses. These are white reporters quoting. So you got all of this stuff, and by the way, I failed to mention, in 1979, Philadelphia became the first city in the country to be prosecuted for police brutality. Think about that. Not Philadelphia, Mississippi. Not some town in Alabama. Not Georgia. Philadelphia under Frank Rizzo became the first city in the country to be prosecuted for widespread, wholesale police brutality. And you give him a statue? To me, that's why I say it's mind-boggling that we're even debating this issue. It's not up for debate. It's so blatant. It's so egregious that folks in Philly, folks in America, and I'm going to get to the whole Confederate statue thing, should be embarrassed. But they're not embarrassed. They promote this stuff. They support this stuff. But getting back to the whole George Washington thing, I was interviewed by Stephan for an article he did about maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago, and when he called me to get my take on the whole Rizzo thing, he might have assumed that I was going to say, in connecting all these monuments that honor folks who I assume to be racist, that they should all come down. And for the most part, that's my position, but not really, because my thing is tell the truth. The whole truth, nothing but the truth. Can you imagine keeping the Frank Rizzo statue and then the 9 half-naked Black Panthers surrounding him at that same site? So tell that story. Have a plaque saying, I'm going to make Attila the Hun look like a faggot. Put that plaque right there. Put the fact that in 1979, in this jurisdiction, Philadelphia became the first city to be prosecuted by the federal government for police brutality. Put that there. So I'm not really so much about taking statues and monuments away. I'm about telling the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So tell that entire story. By the way, I got this thing where I talk about to me, statues are not as important as statutes. What I mean by that is, I'm more concerned about law, legislation, statutes, in terms of seeking racial justice. The fact that a statue is either put up or taken down doesn't really change the day-to-day life of the average black man, woman, and child. However, we can, if the purpose of a monument, I think for the most part, and I defer to the good doctor to correct me on this, but the purpose to me of a monument is to remember and honor. To remember and to honor. So there shouldn't be a debate about should we remember and honor a man who, getting back to Christopher Columbus, his son writes in his diary about San Fernando, some of the horrible things that his father Christopher did to the indigenous people. A Catholic priest was with Columbus when he was doing his thing. The priest wrote that the horrors committed by Columbus were so inhumane and outrageous that the priest trembled as he wrote about it. One of Columbus's shipmates, a guy named Cuneo, talked about not only the rapes, wholesale rape of the brown and red people, but the wholesale rapes of brown and red people who were children. And Columbus in his diary wrote, girls age 9 to 10 are in most demand. Christopher Columbus wrote that in his diary. Christopher Columbus, when he arrived in 1492 in the so-called New World, there were about 8 to 10 million red and brown people. By the time he left in 1504, there were 100,000. 8 million when he arrived, 100,000 when he left. It gets even worse in terms of the documentation. His crimes were so egregious that the regional governor sent him back to Spain, where he was prosecuted for crimes against humanity, and confessed to them, and was sentenced to prison. He's a convicted felon, a mass murderer. And again, we go back to the question of this debate, should he be memorialized? If we were in Germany, and somebody talked about a statue to Hitler, the response would be obvious, 6 million or so. If we were in Russia, and today there was talk about a statue to Stalin, well, most forward-thinking Russians would be like, nah, about 8 million kill, I don't think so. If we were in the Congo, and somebody talked about a statue to King Leopold of Belgium, 8, 9, 10 million square, it would be like, nah, I don't think so. If we know that it's wrong to honor Hitler and Stalin and King Leopold, why are we even talking about Columbus? It's the very same thing. And let me wrap this up by talking about these monuments. Many people say that in terms of the Confederacy, I'm going to focus on that in my final 2 minutes, the Confederacy. They say, I don't know why you black people and progressive white people, why you want to take these monuments down? Because it's not about race, it's about Southern heritage. These monuments to the Confederacy, it's not about race, it's about Southern heritage. Let me just read this to you. I write a weekly column for the Philadelphia Tribune, and a couple weeks ago I wrote this. 80% of the 718 Confederate state and federal statues and monuments weren't erected until 1898 to 1920. 80% of the monuments to the Confederacy weren't even installed until around 1900 to 1920. Last time I checked, the Civil War ended around in 1865. So if it was really about Southern heritage, do something in 1866, 1870, 1875. Why is it that it wasn't until 1898, until 1920, that 80% of the monuments? This is the answer. In 1896, there was a famous decision called Plessy versus Ferguson, which legitimized the whole notion of separate is equal. Clearly, we know it's not, but okay, we got the Plessy versus Ferguson in 1898, but we got all these statues coming up around the same time during a 20-year period. But it doesn't stop there. Between 1915 and 1922, that same time period, there were more lynchings than at any other time in American history. So at the same time these monuments are coming up, you got the Plessy versus Ferguson, you got the lynchings, it seems that something is going on, and what's going on? What's going on is the backlash to Reconstruction. White folks were outraged that black folks were talking about some semblance of justice. I talked about the 718 Confederate monuments. What about the 9 official Confederate holidays in 6 southern states and 10 military sites named after Confederate leaders? And people might say, well, yeah, but it really wasn't that bad. All these Confederate leaders, they really weren't racist. They were about states' rights. If you want to make that argument, let me read this. One of the Confederate leaders who's memorialized at a civilian public site is Lieutenant General Nathan Bedford Forrest. There's a 9,000-pound statue in his honor at Health Services Park in Memphis. Not only was he a slave trader, he was a war criminal who, during the 1864 Fort Pillow Massacre in Henning, Tennessee, slaughtered nearly 400 unarmed black Union Army soldiers. Oh, and by the way, he was the Grand Wizard of the KKK. There's a 9,000-pound statue in his honor. You might say, well, that was just him. That has nothing to do with the Confederacy, because the Confederacy is clear about states' rights, and our flag represents that. Let me wrap this up by saying this. The Confederate flag was originally adopted in 1861. It was about racism then, as it's about racism now. Is that because it's angry black guys saying it? Well, yeah, that's true. But it's really not that reason. There's another reason. Confederate Vice President Alexander H. Stephens of Georgia, this is what he said. He gave the famous 1861 Cornerstone speech. And in his words, this is what he said. So anytime somebody tells you that the flag was not about and is not about racism, quote the Cornerstone speech, where in 1861 he stated, quote, "African slavery is the proper status of the Negro in our form of civilization. The Negro is not equal to the white man, and slavery, subordination to the superior race, is his natural and normal condition," unquote. He then went on to say that African slavery was the immediate cause of the present revolution. He was talking about the Civil War. I really shouldn't have to say all this to you, because it's clear, it's a given, that some people should not be memorialized. If you're a mass murderer, you shouldn't be. If you're a traitor to your country, and that's what the Confederacy was, they committed treason. Think about that. They took up arms against the United States. And by the way, the fake president said, if we get rid of the Confederate leaders today, then it's going to be a problem if we've got to get rid of George Washington and Thomas Jefferson. What the hell is he talking about? Anybody who knows me knows that I'm no fan of George Washington or Thomas Jefferson, but they were American patriots. They were clearly American patriots. The Confederacy went against everything George Washington stood for, everything Thomas Jefferson stood for, and you memorialize those traitors? I'm getting really angry. Thank you.
When the Rizzo statue was put up in Municipal Services Plaza, across the street was what was called Dilworth Plaza, which Richardson Dilworth Andre Richardson Dilworth, who was arguably the most effective and dynamic mayor the city's ever had, and was utterly loathed by Rizzo and returned that feeling to Rizzo. Rizzo fought the, really opposed the creation of Dilworth Plaza, which ultimately had to live. And then in 1972 or so, a memorial to Dilworth was erected in the Plaza in that sunken area, and which Rizzo, who's often considered to be charming, refused to attend the dedication of. But so across the street from Rizzo, who seemed to be waiting at the Dilworth Memorial, was Dilworth with his spiky fingers sticking up. Now that memorial was removed a couple of years ago, but there was no outcry over that. Now, I would contend that one of the reasons for that is that the city has privatized that space, and in the process of the rehabilitation and renovation of Dilworth Plaza and creation of Dilworth Park, which is quite nice, Dilworth had to go. So I mean, now if you want to see Dilworth, you got to go down to Dock Street, which you know, might be more appropriate anyway, because he was so instrumental in the resurgence of Society Hill. But the creeping corporatization of what was once public space is a concern, because what goes into those spaces goes in there without any public voice. So bear that in mind. You could move the Rizzo statue across the street, which many people actually wanted to do 20 years, 30 years ago when it was erected. In fact, the municipal services building was the plaza there was a compromise choice. The original site was over near Love Park, but it was controversy then. But
I,
anyway.
I might add too, I just add a quick pitch that like municipal services building replaced open public space, right? That was not public space forever, but the city had created, I believe it was Rayburn Plaza, it was called at that time.
It had been the Chinese Wall.
Right. So the city had created public space between about what, 1908 and 1930. So it's always this push and pull, and I do think we're in this era of privatization or corporatization, but a lot of the public spaces that we see as sort of always having been there in many cases were created and sort of made public at certain points. So just as I say that as a way of thinking about sort of the push and pull between creating public and private space, but it can also be a lesson that what is private space today does not always have to be private space, right? That we are always free to create more public spaces as well.
I think we might want to draw anybody who has questions or comments?
In fact, Stephan, before we do that, can I just make two quick points that I want to hear from you? The first thing is, I was so angry when I got up to give my speech, I said Richard Baldwin instead of James Baldwin. That was just a test. I'm going to make sure. And the second thing I forgot to mention is, this speaks volumes what I'm about to say. You got Joe Frazier, the heavyweight champion of the world, a real black fighter from Philly, gets no statue on public property. A fake white guy who never threw a punch in his life is, every time I drive past the art museum, there's lines of tourists watching him. They know nothing about Joe Frazier, but everything about Rocky. That speaks volumes about Philadelphia, about Pennsylvania, about the United States.
Yes.
There's still no statue for Paul Robeson.
Same.
Yeah. Where did it go?
It's lost. It was here. It was removed from Rittenhouse Square after a very brief display. Then Salome took it to New York and was shown in New York. No, it wasn't shown in New York. They refused to show it. And then he took it to Paris, where it was on display. And he had to leave while it was still on exhibition, I've forgotten exactly where, and it vanished.
It vanished?
It vanished. It may still be somewhere in a warehouse in Paris. If anyone wants to go, let me know. I'd be happy to come along.
Somebody back.
Yeah,
yeah.
Something
you're
going to speak.
I want to know, how much does ethnicity have to do with
Rizzo's
work? Certain statues or monuments, or keeping them up.
Well, Rizzo was completely out of the effort. You know, it was money, power, and persistence are what make monuments. And Rizzo's statue was backed by his family, first and foremost, and his political cronies and friends. And they pushed and raised money and proposed. It was controversial when it was erected, but you know they were all basically from South Philadelphia. His audience from South Philadelphia, and that's most of the people who were very concerned about the Columbus monuments as well.
In fact, Stephan, I'll wait until she's finished.
Well, I was wondering, does that still hold today? Neighborhoods
of
the city has changed so much.
Well, it hasn't really changed. There's an awful lot of pushback on Rizzo's statue.
I mean, neighborhoods.
Pardon me?
Neighborhoods have changed.
Who lives in the neighborhood?
Yes. Yeah. Well, that is true.
40 years.
It is true. There's still an awful lot of Rizzo's pals around who don't want that move.
And I think the issue is, so it's been funded privately, right? But then the question is, it's on public, right?
Oh, yes.
It's very prominent public space. So it's to me, the question is, you know, does ethnicity have something to do with it? Yes, but I think that the issue with the Rizzo statue, you know, Michael's right, there are absolutely people who should not be memorialized or not. Then there's also an issue, should people be on public, should certain memorials be on public space? Right? Should this be in front of the municipal services building if it was paid for by a private memorial foundation? So, you know, a slightly different question, but one way of looking at it would be who has the power to raise money for either a particular ethnic heritage group or a particular private interest, and should that then be placed in public space, in this case owned by the municipality, is how this is possible.
Are they, is the city contracted to take care of the Rizzo statue? Like, is it their property?
I believe it's the Association for Public Art. So they're in charge of caring for and approving public
Is that
statues.
Well,
actually, I think the statue was given by the donors to the city, and the city is now recommended that the Art Commission, the City Art Commission, address the question of whether it should stay or go.
And speaking of the Rizzo statue, if anybody's interested in some good legal representation and entertainment, two guys were accused of defacing the statue. One a young white guy and one a young black guy. I'm representing both of them. And the first trial is coming up on October 10th, so we encourage people to show up because there's going to be a lot of questions similar to what you just raised about who's the owner of the property, who maintains it, but that's all I'll say about that. Somebody asked where. It's the first trial is October 10, 11:30, Criminal Justice Center at 13th and Filbert in courtroom B03. October 10, 11:30, courtroom B03 at the Criminal Justice Center.
We have a question. Good evening. My name is Hassan Tawadi, Criminal Attorney. And I've only lived here in Philadelphia about 2 years, but I'm fascinated by some of these public struggles about space. But I'm old enough to remember the struggles about space we had 40 years ago when we called the urban renewal. Now it's called gentrification. When whole neighborhoods were removed to create highways, where we had neighborhoods with churches and businesses and houses and all that. So when things are put in place, like a Rizzo statue or whatever, what is this place? And where do those people and neighborhoods and those things go? And particular to a Rizzo and the statue, I think people need to keep in mind that some of the people who Rizzo and his goons terrorized. Some of those people are still alive, walking around in Philadelphia.
Yes.
And they carry scars. So it's not just a, you know, a piece of structure up on the middle of a public space. We're talking about real people's lives who have to sometimes walk by that area and see and be reminded about what he did to them.
Yes.
And to that last point, I think that I also agree with, you know, statutes are important, law is absolutely important. But I think we need to pay attention to both things,
yes.
Right? Statutes and statutes, right? You know, this is the point you're making as
yes.
well. And I think it's important to say that environment matters to people. Statutes matter to people, particularly in dealing, living memory, as you point out, is a very powerful thing. And it is absolutely, I think, crucial that we recognize that environments are an important thing that do affect quality of life. In a serious way, as well as law, as well as a lot of other things.
And this is how the truth.
Yes, yes.
But you know, referring back to your initial point about the history of space, if you look at the terrible destruction that was wrought by the construction of I-95 here in Philadelphia, talk about neighborhoods being wiped out, they were just decimated. And what's happened is that PennDOT has funded, along with other sources, archaeological excavations along the I-95 corridor in Philadelphia. And what have they come up with? They've come up with hundreds and hundreds of thousands of Indian native artifacts, which indicate that this is an occupied place going back thousands of years, which is, you know, speaks to the ever-changing nature of the place, and each we all think of it as our own, but it's not. It's got the ownership that goes back farther than we can even imagine.
Well, I think to that point, and to your first point about displacement, I think it's important to think about public decisions about not just public statuary, but also about public space. Creating these public spaces is creating the public, right? And so when we make a decision about what goes up or if a highway is public space, we're making a decision about who we include in the public, right? Who are these stakeholders who are the public? So then that sort of ties back to this issue. It's not just that environments are important, but that these are the ways that we define who holds the stakes or who think we should hold stakes in these projects.
That's an important point with regard to the President's House that Michael was so involved in, because, you know, attack raised an issue, and they came out of nowhere, and the Park Service said, whoa, what's going on here? Because the Park Service at first was going to do nothing, and then they were going to put up a plaque, and now we have the President's House, and
that was the story. That was nine
and three. Right, and it's only because another voice was listened to. You asserted yourselves into that situation and compelled them to listen to you.
Let's just insert another voice here.
Okay.
Yes.
I just had a quick comment. In fact, I thought it was ironic, but we're in the perfect place for it, that you're talking about public space and archaeology. Since Pennsylvania was owned by Native Americans, it was all public space at that time. The question came up about monuments and Confederate monuments. Here in the Delaware Valley, we do have one, and I say it's in public space because it is at a federally paid for burial ground at Finns Point in South Jersey. Where the Confederate soldiers that were at Fort Delaware were buried. And there's a large obelisk there. So, just for clarification, I thought you'd find that
interesting. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
I'm on this side, and then I'll get around to the other.
I wonder if we aren't taking a overly small-minded view of monuments. But when I see a monument, certainly any monument I remember, it's not a monument that says, boy, this fellow was an ideal human being. It's a monument saying, this guy or this lady did something that we ought to remember. So I take Christopher Columbus as an example. I don't see any monuments that say, boy, we should all stick it to the Amerindians like this guy did. We remember him because he represented the introduction of European civilization on this side of the Atlantic, for better or worse. I think we're focusing too much on who are these individuals and are they perfect human beings.
I don't know why everybody's looking at me.
Agency, memorialization, and
pockets of it's still based in power. So the question will always be to the people who want to put up monuments or take down monuments, do they have the power to do it? And is this in these two American projects, one who's always been saying America hasn't lived up to its right, that's the African American project, right? To get America to live up to its principle. Where the European American project has been to celebrate its ability to conquer space. Right? So we can't lose sight of when we're talking about memorialization or whatever, what we really are talking about, and are we looking at these people who have power and those who don't? And are we going to support those who have power or are we not? Because the American project is still going on. I mean, the Confederates won twice, right? They won in separating, and that was a long debate. That was a debate from the development of the Declaration of Independence about there. But the other side also was involved. So I think when we're talking about memorializing things, we got to not lose focus that we're talking about groups in Philadelphia, particularly, because everybody says it's an ethnic city. Right? Even if the population numbers are changing, there's still ethnic groups. And particularly for African Americans, there is no recognition of issues that have been identified. Even in this institution, the decision to collect African American bibliophiles or information was a decision not to do as a part of Pennsylvania issue. So I think that we should need to keep that in mind.
Thank you.
Black and white guy who fought against slavery.
That's right. John Brown.
That turns to be celebrated in monument in Richmond.
I did hear that.
We have two comments.
Yeah, I have two things to say. One is the schools and colleges historically miseducate and downright lie about this. And for example, Christopher Columbus, or that his son had his diary, or what Christopher Columbus wrote in his diary, and that's not in the school. And the important thing about that, in monuments, when you have people in monuments, people think, you say people aren't all good or all bad, but they think these people want somebody worthy of respect, and they're not. So, in the schools, particularly colleges, a lot of them were built by slavery or having some interest in slavery, such as the University of Penn. Another thing is, there was a black man that lived in this city and he died at 105 years old, named Samuel Evans. He created, one thing he did was sue the city and got half a million dollars, I think it was 500 million. But anyhow, he got some money. But he also put some statues up on Kelly Drive with about four or five of them. I actually saw them with my eyes. But they were only up there for a short amount of time. I don't know where they are now. I wonder if anybody else has a memory of those statues that were on Kelly Drive.
Black statues?
Yeah, of black people on Kelly Drive.
I don't, I'm not aware of it, but I will be tonight.
I agree with you, sir. The assumption that when you're looking at a monument, that this is someone who has great qualities. For me, the crunch comes when I explain it to my grandchildren.
Yes.
My five-year-old knows that some people are memorialized or honored in monuments and some people aren't. And she doesn't focus on their flaws. She wants to know why they're memorialized and I'm not. my own assumption, I'm a proud graduate of Bryn Mawr, and I always honored M. Carey Thomas. I never did my homework, and I assumed that her place at Bryn Mawr was very well deserved. And so the present revelations call me into question for how come I didn't find out. Her writings are available to anybody, and I should have looked at that. So I hold myself accountable for that. But I want to say one thing about Joe Frazier, because he's a friend of mine. We used to drive past his training gym all the time with our young children, and we'd look for his limo. And when his limo was there, the children would want to go over and say hello to him. It meant a lot to us to know that he was in that community. Now, of course, it's a discount from Chester. And it breaks my heart to not have that site somehow memorialized in his honor, because he accomplished so much right here at Broadway.
To that point, the building has been is on the Philadelphia Register. It was certified by the Philadelphia Historical Commission a couple of years ago. So.
But it looks like a dump.
It always looked like a dump.
Yeah. Well, it always looked like a dump. Now it's not supposed to look like a dump.
I was just thinking about one way to democratize, or allow regular folks to set up memorials is through technology. And then when you think about Monument Lab and Marissa Williamson's augmented reality project that she did, Sweet Cherry, where she went to 9 different places where you could bring it up on your phone and look at it. That's one way we could kind of mess around with the Rizzo statue, actually. We had an angry black man go up with your phone and put in that the Rizzo statue and have an angry black man tell him the story about that. Frank Rizzo. But I was wondering,
that's a great
one. You guys have any examples of how technology can be used?
I'm not aware of how technology is being used.
Well, I know that there's a P piece in Washington Square Park that makes use of augmented reality. So that the artist, the young artist from Mark, Rizzo Williams, created a number of performances, and you can also scratch that. You scratch off a square, and it takes you to directs you to a spot. And you hold your phone over, and a performance takes place that she previously created. So she's done this. It's not just in Washington Square Park, but she follows. She takes on the persona of a young woman whose gravestone was uncovered during the Bethel burial ground excavation, actually. She goes down to Bethel. So you can follow this trail. You start in Washington Square at a couple of spots. You go down to Bethel, and she heads up to 6th Street across from the Constitution Center, where Pennsylvania Hall once stood. It was burned down first week after it was built by racists. So anyway, there are a lot of possibilities
I love that idea of technology, and it's something I didn't factor in because I'm thinking about the standard conventional type of memorial, but your idea is so great.
Yeah.
I'm a member of the Mayor's Oversight Committee on Bethel Burial Ground. At the next meeting, I'm going to bring that idea up and take full credit for it.
I think we've got one back here. We'll take the person up front, and then maybe we'll...
But I just wanted to say, I live in the Rizzo era. We were involved in civil rights movement here in Philadelphia as teenagers. And a lot of our folks were subjected to the brutality there. Did not matter. I've never heard him at the state building. We were brutalized at the state building. And I've never seen people beat that bad in my life, where you could hear the United States on somebody's head. That was my first arrest as a teenager, 16. And a lot of things had gone on in the city, at Girard College, backing the trucks and the cars up so that would gas the people that were laying out there at night doing the demonstrations. What happened, there was a little house there where the guards stayed. They got sick because the carbon monoxide got in the building, and they were appreciating people outside. So we experienced these things, peace brutality, running over the kids, and it didn't matter whether you were a child, whether you were an infant, an older person. They ran motorcycles up on people at Girard College in a small area now. This wasn't out there in the street. This was in a contained area. And the sad part about it, the head of our organization, we called them militants back then. Freedom George was being beaten so bad. One of the police commissioners was out there. He got beat too. Rizzo talked about him like a dog the next day because he intervened because it was so brutal. So we lived through these things. When the statue went up, I really couldn't care. I said, oh, they're going to put the statue up to this man. But after, I didn't care. But I just felt the people felt strongly enough that they did not want that statue there. I would go along with it. But if they did not move the statue, there needed to be a statue of Cecil B. Moore standing next to Rizzo, because he's the man that fought police brutality in this city. And he was very strong about it. And he did a lot of things, getting people to vote, getting black people in different schools, fighting the institutions, getting airplane pilots. This man is the best kept secret in Philadelphia. And at this point now, we're trying to get Receptor, negotiate Receptor to do something more to make that Cecil B. Moore substation, subway station, a historical site that people can come to and learn. The city of Philadelphia and the people in North Philadelphia and all over put their lives on the line to make America a better place.
Thank you.
There are some more kinds of things that can probably be written elsewhere, part of the Monumental Lab project, where you can look in these sort of, there are kind of things that are used if you want to see a view, look out somewhere far away, but instead of looking to see something far away, you're looking inside, and the artists have made it so that you see things that might have happened where you're standing in the past, so you can look in it and see people burning draft cards, and you can see a gay pride march and things that might have been there before. So it's in Rittenhouse Square, there's two of them, one on either corner of the same.
I know some people still have some things they want to say. Certainly you can stay a few more moments and talk with each other. But I think for the sake of the program, we need to wrap up. And I really want to thank all of you for coming and participating, and thank our panelists.